Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
How many of you were here 10 years ago when these deities were welcomed here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Nice. So it's been 10 long years since Gaur Nithai have been worshipped here with devotion by the mother-daughter duo of Ramila Mataji and Shilpa Mataji. And they look very happy, the deities I mean. And because of that, both of you also look very happy, I'm sure. That is a real source of happiness. If you keep Krishna happy, you will be happy. Krishna is always happy actually. He is Atma Ram. He is internally always self-satisfied. But if we strive to please Krishna, then Krishna will be even more pleased. There is no limit to His pleasure. So He will be even more pleased. And when He is pleased like that, then we become happy. This is the secret of happiness. Who doesn't want to be happy? Please raise your hand. Anybody? Who wants to be happy? Everybody. So here is the secret formula which you will find only amongst the devotees. Try to make Krishna happy and you will be happy. But you can't make him happy whimsically. I mean, we can't concoct a way to make Krishna happy. You know, one time in England, one gentleman asked me, you're saying we should offer, because I had been speaking about Patram Pushpam Palam Toyam Yome Bhaktya Prayachiti, the verse of Bhagavad Gita, which, in which Krishna mentions that if one offers to me a leaf, a fruit, a flower, or some water with devotion, then I will happily accept it. The word ashnami actually means I will eat. Literally it means eat. Actually it means he will accept it. So then he asked the question, if I offer him alcohol and then I drink it, so I'm offering him whatever I eat and drink, so what is wrong with that? So I said, Krishna says, Patram Pushpam Palam Toyam, not beeram, whiskyam, whatever, ramam, ginam. Yes? He doesn't say that. Had he said, he wouldn't, but just for argument's sake, had he said this, that you can take alcohol and offer to me and have it, then all right. But he hasn't said that. He has said you should offer him a leaf, a fruit, flower, a water, offer him pure vegetarian foodstuffs. So you cannot invent your ways of trying to satisfy Krishna. Krishna has given the different ways in which he can be satisfied. And we have to follow that. And we learn that from the disciplic succession coming from Krishna and from the scriptures. It is not for you and me to decide. I will, according to our imaginative ways, that this is how I will please Krishna today. That is given in our shastras. And then under the guidance of the spiritual master, we will be told, all right, there will be so many other ways in which you can serve Krishna within these boundaries, within these parameters. So Srila Prabhupada was such a genius guru that he evolved and devised innumerable ways in which devotees could be engaged, their talents, their abilities, their enthusiasm could be tapped gainfully, productively for spreading the Krishna consciousness movement to please Krishna. So therefore, the genius of a devotee lies in understanding what pleases Krishna and then devising ways practically to ensure that we can all do the same. So Prabhupada devised so many ways within ISKCON. There's book distribution, deity worship, temple construction, managing a temple, giving lectures to students or to other people, going home and doing programs, worshipping the deities, innumerable ways. Actually, there is no limit. Just as there is no limit to the number of ways in which you can forget Krishna, there is also no limit to the number of ways in which you can remember Krishna and love Him and serve Him. But that has to fall within the boundaries of what the scriptures say and what the acharyas say. The other day in London, I was speaking on this topic in response to a question, that there is a famous verse that Srila Rupa Goswami speaks in his Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, the nectar of devotion. And he says, the standard of first class devotion or devotional service to the Supreme Lord is that it should be done for the pleasure of Krishna, and it should be devoid of any fruitive mentality or any philosophical speculation. The famous verse, I'm sure you all know it, Anya Bhilashita Shunyam Yana Karma Dhyanavritam Anukulena Krishna Nushilanam Bhakti Ruttama. So Uttama Bhakti, or the topmost, or the first class Bhakti, as Prabhupada defined it, is where we act for the pleasure of Lord Krishna. It is a process. It has to be cultivated. Anushilanam refers to the process of regularly doing something, systematically, methodically, regularly, persistently doing something. It's not a one-off thing. It's not something that you just do once in a while when you feel like it. Inasmuch as when a plant is being cultivated, is being grown, you sow the seed and you have to pay so much attention to the plant. You have to water from time to time. You have to protect the plant from grazing animals and from so many other things, from pests and so on. So in the same way, the creeper of devotion within our hearts, which has emerged as a result of the seed of devotional service being sown within our hearts by the mercy of Guru and Krishna, that has to be nourished and nurtured by the water of hearing and chanting about Krishna, the messages of Krishna, the names of Krishna, pastimes of Krishna, and then it grows. So it's a very systematic thing, a regularly performed activity. So also devotional service. The word anushilanam means it has to be regularly done every day. There's no holiday from Krishna consciousness. Now I have my summer holiday. So in this summer, no chanting. Or we have our winter vacation. So no chanting, no hearing now, because we'll take a vacation from Krishna consciousness. Be it a happy occasion, be it a sad occasion, be it a neutral occasion, be it no occasion at all. But every occasion is a right occasion to hear and chant about Krishna. So regular cultivation to Krishna, Krishna Anushilanam, not to anybody and everybody, not to the demigods, not to human beings, powerful human beings, not to ghosts and spirits. Yes, everywhere it's done, not just in India, even in England. I was mentioning this on my last visit to England, that when I was flying down from India to England in the plane, in the aeroplane, there was a newspaper. They had kept a newspaper from England, and there was an article about a young boy and girl. There was some kind of couple, and they were into drinking blood. Big article, one of these famous English newspapers. And that was their habit. So they had kind of long teeth, you know, like Dracula and those kind of things. So they were into ghost worship. Now, I didn't realize that these things happened in England. But they happened. They happened. Dracula was from somewhere in Europe, wasn't he? Somewhere, huh? So, Romania or somewhere. Okay. So actually it happens all over the world. So whatever Krishna is saying in the Bhagavad Gita is not just for India. It's all over the world. These things are happening everywhere. All sorts of tamasic or worship in the mode of ignorance. So we have to worship Krishna and things and people connected to Krishna. Like the expansions or the avatars of Krishna, like Lord Ram, Lord Narasimha, and the things connected to Krishna, which are actually living entities, like the Tulsi, the Ganges, Yamuna, the Vaishnavas. We serve them because they are connected to Krishna. And very importantly, Anukulyena. The word Anukulyena means that it has to be rendered favorably. Now, it's not important, or it is important, but it's not the only condition that you must please Krishna. More important in devotional service than pleasing Krishna is the intention to please Krishna. What did I just say? Did I say right? More important than pleasing Krishna is intention to please Krishna. But that intention has to be also within the parameters, the boundaries that I just mentioned. Not whimsically, but according to what the Shastras say, what Gurus say, what the Guru Parampara says. Within that boundary, within the instructions that we have been given, we have to have the very sincere desire to please Krishna. If our life is devoted to this one simple principle of wanting to please Krishna, our life will be successful and we will be happy. Even if we are in deep anxiety, we will be happy. Now you say, what is this lecture? Very strange things we are hearing today. All sorts of contradictory things. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, whose song we just sung now, he mentions, "Oh my dear Lord, the agonies that I feel in the discharge of your devotional service are my ecstasies." You know, when we serve Krishna, there's so many difficulties and challenges that we encounter. Srila Prabhupada used to say, you know, the yogis who are sitting in meditation in the Himalayas, they may be bare-chested sitting in the snow and drilling their respiration with so much of breathing exercises to keep themselves warm, and they never have headaches because they don't take anybody else's problems. They're not worried about spreading Krishna consciousness or anything. They're only worried about their own salvation. So they're living their own life. But Prabhupada said, "I have so many headaches. I have to deal with spreading this whole movement all over the world." And at that time, you will remember from reading Prabhupada Lilamrita and the other literature that the Krishna consciousness movement was growing very rapidly. And so rapidly, in fact, that the world was getting alarmed. Governments were getting alarmed. In fact, in some governments, there was actual discussion going on that they would take over the government in a particular country. It was growing that fast. And then naturally there were spies who infiltrated into the devotee community just to see what the agenda, hidden agenda was, and they found there was no hidden agenda. Actually the agenda was to spread pure love of Krishna everywhere. And I guess some of the spies must have become devotees themselves. And sometimes it was false propaganda, just sheer malicious propaganda. I remember in India, in the old days, you know, we were always considered, you know, the moment they heard ISKCON, they would say, "Oh, CIA spies. You're all CIA spies." Because there were a lot of Westerners, so they say, "All CIA agents." See, this was what the common man would speak, you know, without thinking, without knowing. Now things have changed a lot, but that was what used to happen. But I'm sure that even if somebody did come with that intention, very quickly he would get purified. So many times the devotees, when they went out in the streets to do Harinam Sankirtan, they went to different places to distribute the books. They were arrested by police. They were put in jail. In some countries like Russia, they were not only imprisoned, but they were tortured. Some of them were put in psychiatric hospitals, injected with all kinds of chemicals which damaged them for life, physically and mentally. So there were lots of challenges. In some places, there were thieves and dacoits that attacked the temple, like in Mayapur, for example. That happened after Srila Prabhupada left, I think. Dacoits came with guns, and they thought that Radharani's ornaments were made of gold, so they wanted to steal the gold. So all sorts of challenges. And then Srila Prabhupada had to hear these reports, and he had to keep his devotees inspired. He had to find some way out. And then in a fledgling organization like that, there were so many problems. Devotees were very new, very immature, and they were quarreling amongst each other, and there were so many problems. Sometimes there was some administrative problem, sometimes there was some other type of interpersonal problem. All day long, Prabhupada was dealing with these issues, plus he was translating books all night. He was meeting leaders and giving lectures every day. What a remarkable personality he was. And he said, therefore, that the yogis have no headaches, but I have so many headaches. But does it mean that the yogis were more advanced than him? Because they were Om Shanti, 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 peace, peace, peace be upon you. There was no peace for Prabhupada. He said, work now, samadhi later. Don't worry about your going back to Godhead and everything. You just practice and spread this Krishna consciousness movement everywhere. That is your samadhi. So the devotees then were fired up with the desire to please Srila Prabhupada. They hankered for just one word of appreciation from Prabhupada saying, very good. Or one little smile from Prabhupada saying, very nice. And that was it. All the hard work they had done, the troubles they had undergone had reached their perfection. They had achieved their purpose. And because Srila Prabhupada was a pure devotee of Krishna, so pleasing Krishna's pure devotees is also very much a part of devotional service. So therefore the intent, the devotees at that time, they said, we don't know Krishna really much, but we know Prabhupada. So they were driven by this intense desire to please Prabhupada. Sometimes they couldn't even understand his accent. He spoke with a heavy Bengali accent in English. Sometimes his terminology was strange to them. But still they knew that here is a person we just want to please and love. And of course, they also gradually started learning the philosophy and understanding why they should be doing it. So this is devotional service. Simply wanting to please Krishna and Krishna's pure devotees and acting according to their instructions. There's no question of trying to please Krishna without following the instructions of the pure devotees. Then that is whimsical, right? So this is the secret of happiness in life. What do you say? Do you agree?
Yes.
Any differences of opinion? Any objections? Yes, it's a simple truth. And that's why our life has to be devoted just for this one purpose. How will Krishna be pleased? When somebody asks Prabhupada, how can I please you? Of course, he gave many answers to this question. And one answer was, by becoming a pure devotee. That's a fundamental thing. So if we sincerely strive to be pure devotees of Krishna, Prabhupada will be happy, Krishna will be happy. and we will actually become pure devotees in course of time. This is the perfection of our life. And how do we become pure devotees? By chanting Hare Krishna, by associating with the devotees, by hearing about Krishna, by reading the Bhagavatam and so on. In this beautiful song that we sung, which is called Shri Naam, it is from a book called Gitavali by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. And he makes some very nice points here. Grihe thako vane thako sada hari bole dako. Whether you live at home as a householder, or whether you're living in the forest as a vanaprastha or a sannyasi, sada hari bole dako, always call out the name of Krishna. Sukhe dukhe bhulo nako vadane hari naam korore. In happiness or in distress, do not forget Krishna. Simply vibrate the syllables of his name on your tongue. Sometimes it happens that we get into a very disturbing or challenging situation and we think, why did Krishna do this to me? And therefore, I will not chant his name. So we get angry with Krishna. Why has he done this? But no, we should keep on chanting. We should never stop our devotional service to Krishna. We recognize that Krishna, even if you're annoyed with Krishna, don't stop chanting. How many of you have got annoyed with Krishna sometimes? Yeah, many people. But don't stop chanting even when you're annoyed with Krishna. You may get annoyed with Krishna, but don't neglect him. You know, one time there was this businessman who wanted to earn a lot of money. He was quite greedy for money. So he was asking around for what's the best form of worship by which I can get money. So then someone told him, you just ask God. So he got a deity of Krishna in his house and he started worshipping this deity. But no profits, I mean, it was the same, there was nothing special happening. Then somebody said, you know, you should worship Durga because she gives a lot of wealth and very quickly. So he said, all right. So he had a deity of Durga in his house and he started worshipping her. And what happened? The money started flowing. Oh, maybe I shouldn't have said this. Yeah? Anyway, I've said it, but you don't do it, okay? Don't do it. So, the money just started flowing. And he was very happy. And then he started thinking, just see, when I started worshipping Durga, you know, she's given me so much money. And this Krishna, I've been worshipping him for so many days and he didn't give me an extra penny. So I'm not going to serve him now. So he thought this when he was doing the arati. He was offering the incense and this thought came to his mind. I am not going to give this to Krishna, only to Durga. So he kept the deity of Krishna in the corner somewhere. So he said, so he was angry with Krishna. So then he was worshipping Durga Devi with the incense. Somehow, the smoke was just flowing in Krishna's direction. It was not going to Durga. He was doing this and the smoke was going there. So he was getting annoyed. Then he shifted position and tried to do like this. But no matter what he did, the smoke was going there. So now he started getting annoyed. Finally, he took some cotton and he went to the deity of Krishna and put it in his nostrils so that he shouldn't be able to smell the incense, even if the smoke drifts to him. And that night, Krishna appeared to him in dream and said, I am very happy with you. He said, whatever for? Because I have, I've given up your worship. And even this incense smell, the smoke that was coming, I wanted to block it from coming to you. So, therefore I put this cotton in your nostrils. So why are you happy? When I didn't put cotton in your nostrils, you weren't happy with me. He said, because after you stopped worshipping me, you were neglecting me. Now at least you're not neglecting me. You know I'm there and you're angry with me, but you don't. At least you think I'm a person. Yes? I exist, and you're recognizing that I exist. One time when I was in America, actually one of my first visits to America, I was standing in the line at the airport for checking in at the counter. It had been a long line and somehow I came there. And there was one Gujarati gentleman who was employed there, and he was directing the traffic. You know, so he saw here somebody like that in saffron cloth. So he wanted to, you know, push me up the line. So I said, you know, the other people ahead of me and they may object. He said, no, don't worry, just come. So I was hesitant, but I went. There was a lady in front of me, and I won't imitate her fully. But in short, she said, hey, I exist. She didn't fight with me, she was fighting with that gentleman. He pacified her and he sent her in a fast track somewhere else, I think. So yes, she was upset because she wasn't consulted, because that gentleman didn't ask her, this gentleman is behind you, can you please come forward? So she just said, I exist, which means she wanted to be acknowledged. You see, one thing, the worst thing you can do to somebody is to ignore that person, isn't it?
Yeah.
You can get angry with someone and fight with the person for a while, and then it's all right, after some time it's okay. But if you ignore the person, then it becomes even more difficult. So this lady was upset because, you know, she wasn't acknowledged. So therefore she said, I exist. So similarly, Krishna wants us to acknowledge that I exist. At least acknowledge that. So even if you're angry with Krishna, at least acknowledge, don't ignore him. You know, you can have your tete-a-tete with him or whatever. You can have your little, you know, your conversations with him. But don't ignore him. Remember, he's always our well-wisher. You're angry today with him, but tomorrow it'll be alright and he's there. So in Krishna consciousness, therefore, never a holiday. Every day is a holy day because it's a day for serving Krishna. It's a life of great happiness, even if there are challenges. So therefore he says here, Sukhe dukhe bhulo na ko vadane harinam karo rahe. Whether you're happy or whether you're unhappy, that has to do with the modes of nature, it has to do with the mind, it has to do with this mad material world, which will always be turbulent and sometimes make us happy, sometimes make us unhappy. When you're in an ocean, the waves sometimes take you up, sometimes bring you crashing down. That's the way of an ocean. So this is also the ocean of material existence. Sometimes things go well, the day is bright, the sun is shining, the birds are singing. Some days, you're down, things don't go well. That's going to happen. We needn't be surprised that there will be such ups and downs in life. But we should never give up devotion to Krishna. We should always remember him and chant his names. Then Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, by the way, this reminds me of how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to say, I will take prasadam only at the house of a millionaire. Not exactly the word millionaire, he used the word Lakshaishwar. Laksha means 100,000, a lakh. In Hindi, in English, you call it lakh, 1 lakh, which means 100,000. Ishwar means the master. So we have a phrase in India called Karodpati or Lakpati. So one who has 10 lakhs, 100 lakhs is called a Karodpati. One who has 100,000 is called a Lakpati. Pati means a master. So he said, I will eat at the house of only one who is a Lakshaishwar, one who has 100,000. So some brahmanas had come to invite him for prasadam and he told him that. So they felt very sad. He said, we are not wealthy, we don't have 100,000 gold coins. I have only 20 gold coins, I have only 2 gold coins, I have only 10 gold coins. He said, no, that's not what I mean. I mean that I will eat prasadam only in the house of one who is chanting 100,000 names of Krishna every day. So that is a real millionaire, or Lakshaishwar. Actually, 1 million is 10 lakhs. But anyway, just so you can understand, I'm giving a rough translation. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted us to become millionaires and billionaires, not necessarily in terms of money, in terms of pounds, shillings and pence, but in terms of the holy names. In the old days, I remember, and nowadays I don't see that happening, but we used to do that a lot. We started this Harinam bank. How many of you heard of this concept of a Harinam bank? Yes? You know, we used to invite people to write the full Mahamantra in notebooks and fill up as many books as possible. And so then they would write the Mahamantra, and they would accumulate books and books and books over the months. They would have a huge quantity of books. And then we would formally, well, you know, have a ceremony in which we appreciated that and declare this person as the wealthiest person. He is a millionaire, billionaire, because he written so many names. And when we had some major ceremony, like for example the groundbreaking ceremony of a major temple or something like that, then according to the rituals, you're supposed to keep many things. You're supposed to dig a hole in the ground where the foundation is going to start. And you have to keep some, you know, a deity of Anantashesh, you have to keep a Bhagavad Gita, you have to keep so many things. So we used to keep that over there, all these notebooks. And that would be the foundation of this temple, because the temple is going to be built on the holy names. So real wealth is chanting Hare Krishna. Interesting, very nice. So how many of you want to become millionaires and billionaires? By chanting Hare Krishna, because this is the wealth that will remain with you. All the other wealth will go away. Then Bhakti Vinod Thakur says, Maya jale baddha hoye acho miche kaj loye. He says, you were caught, oh my dear friend, you were caught in the net of Maya. And you have engrossed yourself in working so hard in this material world, forgetting Krishna, simply because you were entrapped in this net of Maya. Net, yes. Web. Net. What does it remind you of? Net, web.
Internet.
The World Wide Web. Yes. Maya jal. Jal means a net, so we have this net of Maya. You call it internet, you can also call it Maya net. So Maya has so many attractive forms in the modern day and age. Then he says, Ekhono chetana peye radha madhava naam bole. Now please come to your real consciousness and chant the holy names of Radha Madhava. This is real consciousness. It's true consciousness. In true consciousness, we become happy. One time, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was doing his Sankirtan at the house of Srivas Thakur, there was this little girl who used to come and serve in Srivas Thakur's house. And the service she did was to bring pots of water from the Ganga. And she would keep them in the around so that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu could use them. So Mahaprabhu noticed, every day he would see that, and one day he noticed in particular these pots of water were stored in very neat lines. He was very pleased. So he said, Srivas Thakur, who does this service? So Srivas Thakur replied, actually it's this little maidservant girl in our house. Her name is Dukhi. Now, Dukhi means the sad one, you see, somehow it's a name. So he said, from today, I will call her Sukhi. Sukhi means the happy one. So Dukhi became Sukhi. And the moment that happened, she actually was in great ecstasy, in devotional ecstasy. And Shivas Thakur said, "My word, what mercy, this girl's life has become successful. She has become happy by getting Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy." Another time also, Shivas Thakur's niece, Narayani, who was the mother of Vrindavan Das Thakur, she became the mother later, of course. At this time, she was only 4 years old. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came and he said, "Narayani, chant Krishna, Krishna, say Krishna." And because of that mercy, she started chanting Hare Krishna and she was in complete ecstasy. She went into a trance of devotion. And everyone around was struck with wonder. So worthy mother, worthy daughter, worthy son. So then she got Vrindavan Das Thakur as her son when she grew up and she got married. Jivana hoilo shesh na bhajile Rishikesh. If you don't worship Rishikesh, Krishna, then life is as good as finished. What is the use of living a life if you cannot worship Krishna? Because in any case, everything will be gone. Everything will be over. It will be lost. We can't take away anything with us. You've heard of this mathematician called Ramanujan? He was a very famous mathematician. He was a prodigy. He grew up in a little village in South India. Very poor family. But his family were Vaishnavas actually. So he had this Vaishnava culture right from his childhood. He was a brilliant mathematician. When he was very young, just about 15 or 16 years old, he was inventing all these mathematical theorems and everything. And one time he took employment as a clerk because, you know, he needed to maintain his family. And in his spare time, he was scribbling on little sheets of paper, all sorts of equations and everything. And his boss, who happened to be an Englishman, saw this. And he said, "My word, this young lad, this seems like some kind of a genius." So then he made some arrangements for him to go to England to study further. And then he came to Cambridge. I think Cambridge or Oxford. Anyway, I think one of the two. So he came here under one professor called Hardy. And then Professor Hardy was also astonished to see this boy's genius, you know. So one day he contracted some illness and he was admitted to the hospital. And so the professor came to see him and he was reading Bhagavad Gita. So then he asked him, "Ramanujam, what is this book? Is it your holy book?" He said, "Yes." "So what does it say?" Now Ramanujam was wondering, how can I explain, how can I make him understand? You know, he's all the time thinking of mathematics, 24 hours mathematics. How do I make him understand what Bhagavad Gita is? He said Bhagavad Gita, so he thought and for a moment and said, "Actually Bhagavad Gita teaches us the value of zero." You know, because he had to bring in some arithmetic into it. He said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, you see, because everything is ultimately zero in this world, is created, is maintained, is destroyed. It's all gone, it's finished at the end. The universe is created, maintained, destroyed, ultimately. We have our house, we build it, then it's destroyed. Our body, created, maintained for a while, destroyed. Everything we have in life ultimately comes down to zero. But we have to rise beyond that and come to the path of devotion." I don't know how much of it he explained, but he mentioned this point. So ultimately everything in this world is that one big zero. In Leicester, just a few days ago, I was explaining how Srila Prabhupada said that everything in this world is zero, but Krishna is the one. And if you put the one in front of the zero, then that zero becomes very meaningful. Just like now we're here in Ramila Mataji's house. There's so many houses exist in Manchester, millions of houses. But those houses in which their lordships reside and where they are worshipped and where the names of Krishna are chanted, those houses are special. So Krishna, there's one, and then the house 10, 0, so it becomes 10. And then you have whatever else you have in this world, keep on adding the zeros and it multiplies by 10 times. But if you remove the one, then the zeros keep on building, but the value is still zero. So therefore, bring Krishna in our life and this world will no longer be a zero. Otherwise, as Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, what is the purpose of living? You're not going to carry away anything at the end of life. So be Krishna conscious and carry away this consciousness. And even if you're not successful in this life, you will get an opportunity in the next life. Bhakti Vinod Upadesh Akpa Naam Rase Mature. So he's making a plea to all of us. He says Bhakti Vinod is pleading with you, you meaning all of us who are reading and hearing the song. He said, please, once at least taste the nectar of chanting Krishna's names. So this is Bhakti Vinod Thakur's mission in life. This is his compassion, because the real happiness can come when we absorb ourselves in Krishna's names. The acharyas know that. So their only business in life is to see that everybody can get this nectar. So I'm very, very happy to be here this evening. It's been 10 long years since the deities came. How many of you have been serving the deities in your homes? It can even be pictures, doesn't matter. Doesn't have to be full deities. Just picture even is fine. How many of you? Many of you. Every one of you, I hope. Very nice. At Leicester also, the same program, I was reading from a purport of Srila Prabhupada, in which he says that in every house, four things must go on. You remember the four things? Who was present at that time? You were present? Remember the four things?
Yeah.
What were the four things?
Chanting of Hare Krishna.
Chanting of Hare Krishna.
Eating only prasadam.
Eating only prasadam.
Worshipping the deity.
Worshipping the deity.
And reading and discussing sacred scriptures like Bhagavatam and Gita.
Wonderful. Reading and discussing various scriptures like the Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam. Mm-hmm. Prabhupada said these four things must be done in every home. And how often?
Twice a day.
BD. Any doctors or nurses here? Oh yeah, one doctor, yes, of course. What is BD?
Twice a day.
Twice a day. What is TDS? Thrice a day. OD is once a day. So BD means twice a day. Bi-daily, is that what it means?
Yes.
Bi-daily, so twice a day. So morning and evening, everybody should do this. And who should do it? Only one member of the family on behalf of everybody else? Whoever is in the house, everybody should do it. BD, these four things. What are the four things? Can somebody else say now? Yes.
Eating only prasadam, reading Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, worshipping the deities and chanting Hare Krishna.
Wonderful, very nice. I think those who answer correctly, we should give them some extra Mahaprasadam today. Okay? Yes. Somebody else, please. What are the four things Prabhupada mentions that should go on in every home, every day? Yes.
Chanting.
Chanting what?
Hare Krishna.
Then?
Eating prasadam. Reading
what?
Bhagavatam.
Okay, Bhagavatam.
And worshipping the deity.
That's right. Wonderful. Whoever wants some more extra prasadam, you have one last chance. Somebody else. One more time. One person. Without being prompted by anybody. At the back, someone, yes. Chanting Hare Krishna, reading Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, eating only prasadam, not only eating prasadam. eating only prasadam. Yeah, there's a difference between only eating prasadam and eating. Yeah. Okay. And then. And deity worship. Excellent. So if you do this every day, life will be happy. Do this with the intention that Prabhupada will be pleased, that Krishna will be pleased, and you will also automatically become pleased. Good proposal?
Yes.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So our best wishes to Ramila Mataji and Shilpa Mataji for having served the deities, and we hope and pray you will continue to serve the deities with devotion. And we hope and pray that every one of you will also continue to serve the deities in your own homes, whether they are pictures or whether they are actual deities. It doesn't make a difference. Serve them nicely and do these four things. And at the same time, come to the temple regularly, participate in the programs there, in the lectures, in the kirtans, associate with devotees nicely, serve the devotees nicely, and make your life perfect. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Any questions? Yes, Srinath Lal Prabhu.
Maharaj, yesterday in class here at Manchester, you mentioned how Krishna consciousness is innate in everyone. And today you mentioned how, you know, our bhakti begins when the seed of bhakti is sown by the spiritual master in one's heart. How do we understand the apparently contradictory, like one is innate and one is sown? And I've heard both. How do you explain that?
Okay, so the question is, it has been said that the loving propensity for Krishna is innate in the heart of every living entity, and it is invoked by practice. So when you practice, then that loving propensity comes to the fore. That's one thing. And today, on the other hand, it was said that it is that the seed of devotional service is something that has been given by the mercy of Guru and Krishna. So this seems like a contradiction. On one hand, it said it's innate, it's there, dormant within, and on the other hand, it is said it is given. So what is the answer? Who would like to answer this? Yes.
Prabhupada writes in a purport in Srimad Bhagavatam, when there is a devotee has seriously anxious about spiritual realization, Krishna gives the knowledge from within as Paramatma and from without, from externally as spiritual master.
Yes, that is right. But the question is, this seems like a contradiction, isn't it? That is the question. On one side we say it is dormant in the heart, Krishna consciousness, and the other hand we say the seed of devotional service is given by somebody. How do we reconcile this?
It's a reawakening.
Huh?
That's what the Guru reawakens.
Yes.
From dormant state to active state.
Yes. That is the correct answer. By the mercy of Guru and Krishna, we are revived from our comatose condition. Comatose, you know comatose?
Mm-hmm.
Coma. From an unconscious condition, we are revived and we wake up. Oh, who am I? Where am I? Yes? Interestingly, what is that Bhakti Lata Beej? What is that seed of devotion that is planted by the spiritual master? Srila Prabhupada mentions in the purport that the seed is constituted of the instructions given by the spiritual master. That constitutes the seed of devotional service. And the spiritual master will give an instruction to one who is generally speaking receptive. If the disciple is qualified to be a disciple and is receptive and is eager like a sponge, soaking it up, when it's a very fertile soil for the seed of those instructions to go in. And once the seed is sown in that fertile soil of the heart of the receptive disciple, then the watering of by hearing and chanting about Krishna goes on. Then the seed becomes a plant. Then the plant of the creeper grows and grows and grows, eventually reaches Goloka Vrindavan. Once it reaches Goloka Vrindavan, it produces a beautiful, delicious fruit called Krishna Prem. And the wonderful thing about this fruit is that even though it appears in Goloka Vrindavan, living here in Manchester, you can taste it. So that is the beauty of the devotional service. So it's there, but it needs to be invoked. So the invoking process comes by the mercy of Guru and Krishna.